enough, it was, again, another coronavirus.
Wow. So before we even go into any more details about these coronaviruses, I want you to help us to understand something that causes a lot of confusion, including for myself. Okay. When we're trying to identify these viruses and we're using PCR, can you explain to us simply what this is and why it is important?
Certainly. So PCR is a very powerful tool. I know a lot of people are learning about it, which is really great. It was invented by Carrie Mullis in the early to mid 80s. So it's really harnessing the power of DNA replication, right? So this is a natural biological process, and we can use this to identify a gene of interest or amplify something to use to research. So it's very simple. We're using synthetic pieces of DNA. So we make these short pieces of DNA that match our gene of interest or area of interest and harness the power again of DNA replication. So using DNA polymerase, we can amplify a specific region of DNA, which then becomes part of further reactions. So that's where you become a chain reaction. So with each cycle, you get a log exponential growth of your specimen. So if you start out with one gene copy, that becomes 2, 4, 8, and so on. So with each cycle, you're getting amplification of your specific gene of interest.
So explain to us then, because this is an RNA virus, so it's not a DNA virus. So how does the PCR work for an RNA virus?
Right. So the first step would be called reverse transcription. So what we do is we take the RNA and turn it into DNA and then use that for further reactions. Now, for the SARS-CoV-2, they're using a modification of PCR, which is called quantitative or real-time PCR. So the power of this is normally when you do a PCR test, in order to say, is what you're looking for there or not, you have to run it on a gel. So you have to visualize it some way. Now, using real-time PCR is fantastic because now we use technology and you can watch on a computer screen each round of replication, and you can see that you can watch as each cycle goes, and so it's visualizing it in real time, and you can see if that actually is being detected or not. Usually the primers or synthetic oligonucleotides have a probe on them, so it fluoresces when a laser hits it. So this machine is using that, and when the laser hits it and it fluoresces, then it shows as a blip on your graph.
Okay, so I've heard lots of comments that we have not been able to identify the virus because the PCR doesn't identify the virus, that kind of thing. Where does that fit in? Does that make any sense? What are people talking about when they speak about those things?
Right. So the main issue is that PCR, while it can detect genes or genetic material, it cannot tell us anything beyond that. So we don't know whether the virus is actively replicating. So is this just a bit of genetic material that we've discovered, or is this a live actually replicating virus? Now, with quantitative PCR, we know that it's quantitative. So it relates to an amount of something. So it's inverse, each cycle is inversely proportional to an amount. In this case would be like amount of virus or a number of gene copies. So the higher the number or the longer it takes to detect that piece of genetic information means that there's very little or the less there is in your starting material, right? So normally when we design or develop PCR assays, we run them for about 20 to 35 cycles. When you start to reach the end, so when you start to get up to your end of cycles, if you still haven't detected anything, then we know there's nothing in the starting material. Now there's some interesting things that can happen with PCR. So as each cycle happens, you start to use up some of the reagents that are in your reaction, right? Now, primers are very promiscuous, okay? They really want to stick to something. So if we get up in the higher cycle range and they cannot find your gene of interest, they're just going to start sticking to each other. So we call this primer dimers. Now, once they stick to each other, they can set off that beacon and it will look like you've detected something. So we know that anything over like 30 cycles is negligible. Could be primer dimers, could be environmental contaminant. Now, for SARS-CoV-2, the crux of the matter is they're running these tests at 45 cycles. When I first heard that the cutoff value for these tests was 40, that set off alarm bells in my head, because I thought, if you're going to say anything up to 40 cycles out of 45 is going to be considered positive, you might as well call everybody positive.
So that's an important point. But if you're doing large numbers of samples, what you're saying is that it increases the numbers of false positives that you get.
Yes, correct.
So will it accurately, therefore, identify the positives?
Yes. So
PCR, but you can't tell what percentage.
Right. PCR is very sensitive and very specific. Now, what we do normally when you develop this assay is you want to do standard control. So in this case, I would say you would determine the titer of your virus. You would make dilutions of that virus. And you would run that at the same time as you run your unknown samples. So then you can compare your unknown sample to those dilutions to determine, is there indeed virus there, and if so, how much? So this should really be done with every single time you're running this assay.
So let me just pause.